written by Alexis C. Lamb, an esteemed NIU alum. It was inspired by the lagoon right outside the music building, late night walks, watching the light glimmer from the lighthouse on the water. This next piece is entitled B by Drake Sau. It's a 5-minute work in which the composer plays with the resonance of the microphone.
Thank you.
experience working with other musicians and watching friendships grow through performance. This is why I was excited when I received a message asking to play this next duet together. Not only did I get to work with a wonderful musician that I had not worked with before, but I also gained a new friend. This work is entitled Protected Sleep by Faye Ellen Silverman. Please join me in welcoming my friend Emma Hinkle to the stage.
Thank you.
This next piece is entitled Don't Look for Me Where Birds Sing by Lila Moretzky. It was inspired by the death of a girl named Bertha Kula, who actually died in the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory. In 2018, the composer turned 20, and she realized that she was older than this girl, Bertha Kula, who lived in the same apartment that she grew up in New York City. Reflecting on that death, she read this poem, and it goes like this. Don't look for me where myrtles are green. You will not find me there, my beloved. Where lives wither at the machines, there is my resting place. Don't look for me where birds sing. You will not find me there, my beloved. I am a slave where chains ring. There is my resting place. Don't look for me where fountains spray. You will not find me there, my beloved. Where tears flow and teeth gnash, there is my resting place. And if you love me with true love, so come to me, my good beloved, and light up my gloomy heart and make sweet my resting place. This is Don't Look for Me Where Birds Sing by Lila Moretzky.
Thank you.
quickly a brief intermission while we move some stuff around.
Yeah.
Here we go. Marimba and Steel Pan, and I was very excited when this person reached out. out to me to play with them. Just like with Emma, it was great making a new friendship out of this. So if you could please help me welcome Jian Chu to the stage. Thank you. entitled Savino by Derek Tywonia. I will be accompanied by a speech delivered by former New York State Senator Diane Savino, speaking on marriage equality all the way back in 2009. You will find that she's poignant and insightful in her observations on American society, many of which are still applicable today.
You know, like Senator Adams, I've spoken on this floor many times myself, and I've never been quite as nervous. Not because I'm not sure of my position, or how I feel, or what I think is the right thing to do. Because I'm not sure what's going to happen, and that's rare in the New York State Senate. Rare that we don't not know the outcome of bills before they come to the floor. And rarely have we faced an issue as important as this without knowing the outcome. Tens of thousands of New Yorkers' lives are hanging in the balance in this state. They are either going to go home today, knowing that we made history here in New York State, or they're going to go home incredibly disappointed, but certainly unbowed, and the struggle will continue. But I hope that we are going to make that history here today. I hope that we're going to take that step forward to continue the promise of Thomas Jefferson that Senator Schneiderman so eloquently talked about, or eradicate the inequality that Senator Adams described so painfully. I hope that we're going to make that choice. Because I reject, even though I have great respect for Senator Diaz, and I do, and he's not here, but I do have great respect for him, and I have great respect for his religious convictions. But this vote is about our politics. It's not about Democratic politics or Republican politics. It's not about who contributed to what campaign. It's not about who tried to make this body one party or another. It has absolutely nothing to do with this. This vote is about an issue of fairness and equality, not political. It is about the fairness of people who are of the right age, of sound mind, who choose to live together, share everything together, and want to be able to have the protections that government grants those of us who have the privilege of marriage and treat it so cavalierly in our society. That's all this is about. Whether Senator Duane and his partner Lewis, who are two of the most committed people I've ever met, I will tell you, I'm over the age of 40, that's what I'm going to get from you. But I've never been able to maintain a relationship of the length or the quality that Tom Duane. Why should they be denied the right to share their life together? I don't know a single McDonald's partner, but I know he is as committed to him as Tom is to Lewis, and as my friend Matt Tony is to his partner Josh. These are relationships that I envy, and in fact, we all should envy. And all they ask for is to be treated fairly and equally, and be able to plan for each other in the event something happens to them. The same way Senator Lanza does with his wife, Marcel, or Senator Flanagan does with his wife, or any of those of us here who are married are able to plan and protect the person that we love. You know, I've also been lobbied, quite interestingly on this bill, by people on both sides. I'll tell you one funny story. It was on 6th Avenue in Manhattan. I was in my car. I was driving to make a left turn onto 52nd Street. I was stopped at a light. I had my window open. And a young man on a pedicab stopped and stuck his head in the window of my car, which I thought was kind of strange. But he recognized the Senate license plate on my car, and this was right during the week that the Assembly was taking up the vote earlier this year. And he said to me, "Excuse me, is there going to be a gay marriage vote in Albany this week?" And I said, "Yes, the Assembly's going to take it up, but the Senate probably won't take it up anytime soon. I'm not sure when." And he said, "Are you going to vote for it?" And I said, "Yes, I am." And he said, "Why?" And I said, because I believe that people should be able to share their life with whoever they want, and the role of government is to administer that contract that they agreed to adhere to. And he stopped and he said, but they're changing the definition of marriage. And I said, get so excited about this marriage stuff. I said, think about this. We just met, you and I, right here in the stoplight. You stuck your head in the window of my car. I said, do you know tomorrow we could go to City Hall, we could apply for a marriage license, and we could get married? I said, and nobody there will ask us about the quality of our relationship, or whether we're committed to each other, or any of those things. They will issue that marriage license and we can get married. And he said, yes, that's true. I said, and do you think we're ready for that kind of commitment? And he stopped and he said, I see your point. And that's really what this is about. We in government don't determine the quality or the validity of people's relationships. If we did, we would not issue three quarters of the marriage licenses we do. And I know there are many people in the religious community who feel that we're going to force this on them, when that in fact is not true. We have never done that.
Shonda versus Headley. Thank you for sharing your time and your talents with me. I know you're all very busy people, so being willing to collaborate with me means the world. In that vein, I would like to extend a second thank you to Rashonda, who wrote the beautiful composition that you're going to hear for the last piece of this recital. I've loved every composition of yours, and I can't wait to hear the rest of them. Thank you to everyone who was in attendance for my dress rehearsal. Your presence both made the night smooth and eased my mind. I'd like to thank my stagehands for this evening, Jenna Brown and Kirby Stevenson. You guys, it really means a lot. Thank you so much. I'd also like to thank Ethan Patterson, who is controlling the audio and the video for tonight. To the percussion educators in my life, thank you. I've grown so much as a musician and also as a person from your guidance from Kentucky. Thank you to Todd Wright and Dr. Jason Kutz. And here at NIU, thank you to Liam T., Yuko Asada, Ben Wallen, and Dr. Greg Beyer. I'm so grateful that I came up here and had the opportunity to work with the four of you, as I learned so much in my short time here. Next, I'd like to thank my family. I would not be a musician if it were not for my wonderfully supportive parents who have sacrificed so much to provide opportunities for me. Thank you for always being in my corner. Thank you for driving 16 hours to be up here today with an 8-year-old in your car for 6 weeks. Thank you to my wonderful niece for coming here. Alice, I'm so glad you got to see Indiana in action. Thank you to my sister and her partner, Josh, who are watching from home. Ashley, I know you'd be here tonight if you weren't busy being a superhuman and finishing grad school yourself. I'm so proud of you. To my best friend, Corey, I have a level of gratitude that I'm not quite sure can be put into words. You dropped everything to move up here with me and have been there for me every step of the way. Oh my God, okay. I know for a fact I would not have been able to do this without you. I'm gonna stop there. Okay, whatever. Finally, thank you to my husband, Matthew. On the many, many days I was convinced I couldn't do this, you helped me see otherwise. Being apart has been the most challenging thing I've ever done, and I know it's just as hard for you. The past 2 years have shown me that I really took making music with you for granted, but I'm so excited to do it again. Okay, I'm sorry. This final piece is entitled Reminiscence by my dear friend Rashonda. When we were discussing the piece, Rashonda spoke to me about the conversations you have with a friend, reflecting on the good and bad times in your life. In those conversations, you realize you must learn to forgive and forget, reminiscing on the good times and learning from the bad. Following this performance, I would be honored for you to join me in the lobby of the concert hall for a brief reception. We have pizza and cupcakes. Please eat some. Okay, here we go. you so much. There really will be pizza and cupcakes in the lobby. I just have to bring them out there. To the percussion studio. There's number 7 on here at 8, and it's 7:48 right now. So,
that has to be good.